taking this shit. I never even made it this far into the song, to be honest.
Yeah, I gotta learn all the lyrics to this. I have to learn all the lyrics to that song.
It would be fitting. It would only be appropriate. Jamo. There's somebody else on this song.
I never made it that far into the song, and she starts rapping.
I think this is somebody else. I don't think this is Ray Strong.
Who comes up with the name of it? Come on. Come on, son. Stop it. Yeah, I saw it. Yeah, radio shit. No, you don't. It's a waste of rap, man. Stop it.
Nonsense over a hot beat.
Well, actually, no, my bad. It's gonna be better. Nah, seriously though, like you can honestly just download the beats, put any verses over it, and you'll be good. You heard what Lil Yachty said, like, oh, no, if I go, if it gets fire, then I'm gonna make a song called Ya. Yeah. What? Yeah. Did you produce a beat? So you didn't make the fucking song!
But see, this is the thing now. I feel like the producers should get more credit than the rappers. The producers get more money than the rappers.
Yeah, that too.
Are you kidding me? It should be called DJ Khaled featuring Lil Yachty.
If you think about it, though, that's how rap actually kind of started, because it was usually like the DJ and then the rapper would just like say a few words.
I guarantee you, if you took a poll of people who listened to that type of music, if you ask them, what do you listen for, like, the lyrical content or the beats, I'm sure, like, at least 75% would say they listen because the beat is hot.
Right. Yeah, you're right.
And Justin's, like, frozen again. I gotta get this.
He looks like he's about to say, fuck.
There you go.
Oh, man. Oh, I was just about to get a picture, too.
You were about to say, fuck.
Should have caught that screenshot.
I was about to, and then you, like, unfroze right as I was taking the picture.
Anyways, though, seriously, I understand that hip-hop started... Honestly, the beats and the lyrics were kind of 50-50. Kind of 50-50. I would say the beats were more so only because that's what started it. People would drop a beat, and then you would spit on the beat. So, obviously, the producer on the beat got more recognition way back in the day. But it's fucking...
The lyrical quality also was a lot better than what it is.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Back in the day, you could rap about fucking taking a walk down the road and what you saw.
Yeah.
And it'd be fine.
And you'd be seeing... And those people would be seeing some shit because they actually grew up in the hood.
Yeah.
So you could walk down the street and see some shit and rap about it, unlike, you know, these white-collar rappers these days who... You know, they got a studio in mommy and daddy's basement, and they just, you know, they just drink enough cough syrup till they sound autistic enough that they can, you know, that they can spin over a beat.
Yeah, what was the radio station for that shit? The one where we shit on old heads.
There was a Lil Vert who was on Hot 97.
Is that on 97?
Ebro tried to put on a DJ premiere beat, and he was like, "Nah, I don't rap on that old people shit."
Oh man! As soon as he said that, I was like, "What are you talking about, man? You're supposed to be a rapper. You should rap on any beat.
This is how you know a rapper is trash, because any rapper could rap on. A rapper's supposed to be able to rap on any beat.
Yeah,
any beat the DJ puts on.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. You're going."
Exactly.
He's gonna change the beat on you. You gotta change your flow, and that's it. That's what makes you a good rapper.
You need to put some pop shit. He's like, my fans will understand. They're like, no, they'll understand that it's trash.
Yeah, I was down when he said that. They'll understand that you're trash. That shit was hilarious. Yo, what's the next genre of music that's gonna pop come out?
I have no idea.
Because we're due for something new.
I'm going with space death hip hop fusion. You ever hear Flying Lotus?
Nah.
Imagine if like Kendrick Lamar rapped over like an Animals as Leaders song.
Okay.
He actually did a song with Kendrick Lamar, and it's fucking sick.
Yeah, he makes beats for like Frank Ocean, a lot of people.
I wish I had an ear for music.
I still kind of want to do it.
Why not? Pursue it, son. You're still young. Yo, J. Cole, how old? I didn't even know that nigga was 30, yo.
He's 31.
Yeah, and he's just getting big.
Yeah.
Well, he was a couple years ago still.
He's been big for a good, like, 5 years now. But that was, like, what? He was 26.
I mean, mainstream, though. He wasn't huge up until he's, like, 29.
2011.
Actually, with Born Sinner.
Before that. 2013. He came out with Drake.
I thought Born Sinner was the one that put him on the map.
No, he had a song before that. Hold on. going to tell you which one.
No, no, I thought Born Sinner was the album that put him out there, like, alright, he's up there.
I'm about to blow up. You know that song?
Was he ever on Double XL?
Yeah, 2010.
Freshman year? 2010?
Yeah. He was with Wale. Yeah.
Wait, 10?
Yeah, 2010.
10?
The funniest thing was, our best podcast probably was without Justin. Probably the most constructive podcast we had.
Yeah, you know, I'm the wild card.
It was
Shelly Day.
It definitely had the least bullshit.
Yeah, definitely.
It was definitely the most productive podcast, but like something was definitely missing. I didn't feel right.
Something's missing. I'm like, yeah, Justin.
The nonsense.
The bullshit.
Yeah, that's what I bring to the table, man. That's what I bring to the table.
I was a terrorist since the public school era. Bathroom passes, cutting classes, squeezing asses. Smoking blunts was a daily routine since 13. A chubby nigga on the scene. I used to have the Trey Deuce and the Deuce Deuce in my bubble goose. Now I got the Mac in my knapsack, lounging black. Smoking sacks up in Axe and Sidekicks with my sidekicks, rocking fly kicks. Honeys wanna chat, but all we wanna know is where the party at. And can I bring my gat? If not, I hope I don't get shot. Better throw my vest on my chest, cause niggas is a mess. It don't take nothing but front for me to start something. Bugging and bucking at niggas like I was duck hunting. Coming out just me and my crew, cause all we wanna do is... My piece, sure do, 222s in my shoes. Holla if you need me, love, I'm in the house. Roman strokes, see what the honeys is about. Moet poppin', hope poppin', ain't no stopping. Big Papa, I'm a bad boy. Niggas wanna front, who got your back? Niggas wanna flex, who got the gat? It ain't hard to tell, I'm the East Coast overdoser. Nigga, you're scared, just a poster. Nigga, I toast ya, put fear in your heart. Fuck up the party before it even start. Is he drunk, over Henny and Skunk, or some brand new shit beating down punk? And bitches in the back looking righteous in a tight dress. I think I might just hit her with a little Biggie 101. How to tote a gun and have fun with Jamaican rum. Conversation, blunts in rotation. My man Big Jock got the Glock in his waist and was smoking, drinking. Got the hooker thinking. If money smell bad, then this nigga Big is stinking. Is it my charm? I got the hookers eating out my palm. She grabbed my arm and said, let's leave calm. I'm hitting skins again. Rolled up another blunt, bought a Heineken. The loped out, a kid got choked out, blows was thrown, and a fucking fight broke out. Yo, chill, man, chill. Can't we just all get along so I can put hickeys on my chest like little Sean? Get a pissy drunk off a Dom Perignon, and it's on, and I'm gone. That's that.
Uptown like stuff.
Welcome to Jess and Bullshit. This is episode 5, I guess. Actually, fuck it. This is episode 1 of the 2016 season. Everything you've heard before this is a lie.
Yep, never happened.
Yep. So welcome.
Aliens took over our bodies.
Welcome to episode one of 2016. Jets lost tonight, 14-6 to the Eagles. So sadly, we cannot begin this podcast with a roast of Eat That Pussy 445. Actually, fuck it. We will anyway. Because
fuck
why
yeah.
not?
He's still really fat.
Hey, EDP.
And he's still trying to eat that pussy that's just not around for him, you know? Shit.
Hey, EDP, if you're listening, fuck you, you fat motherfucker. Go climb up some more hills.
The only thing, the one thing that he's never eaten is his actual name.
Yes. True.
Well, actually, you never know. Maybe he's one of those dudes that you need to hook up with David Shawn to get rid of those fat girls.
Have you seen his videos? I doubt he's hooking up with any fat girls. He posted something on Twitter today. He's like, I can't wait for this white girl that I stalk on Instagram to post more pictures of her showing off her tits so I can jack off to them. It's like, dude.
He is crazy. He does not give
dude, there is an unspoken code. Like, we all jerk off the pictures on Instagram, but we don't talk about it.
It's gonna be don't never eat that pussy anymore.
And his weight will always be 445 because as much as he exercises, he does not understand the concept of dieting. And anytime someone tries to give him any advice on dieting, he writes it off. Like, I guess someone told him, like, yo, you know drinking, like, sugary drinks, like, fruit punch and shit like that is, like, just as bad as drinking soda. And he was like, man, fuck you. Like, don't tell me that.
He really thinks, like, everyone is his enemy. Like, no one tries to help him at all. He's, like, he sounds, like, real insecure about himself.
Million dollar idea. Get one of those, what was that, Big Mamas? Get one of those fat suits that Eddie Murphy is wearing. Create a whole new persona and just make money off that shit. There you go. Eat That Pussy's gotta be making money.
He's making money.
Yeah, without a doubt. He definitely is.
He's talked in his videos about how he's making money off of YouTube.
Like, I have a whole bunch of people fucking fat shame me and shit.
He made this one video where he's like, he made one of those shout outs to my haters videos where he's like, oh, if you're clicking on my video to like make fun of me, well, thank you, because you're actually paying me by listening to my fucking video.
There was this one video where he was talking about making a gym membership, and he like opened up a GoFundMe for people to sign up for a gym membership. And this one kid, who apparently was like his boy, and he just like went off on a tangent. He was like, I can't believe you're begging for money just to sign up for a gym. And he was like, this is a disgrace. And he was like saying, this was the kid who was talking about how my mother died. And he asked, oh, did she die because she was fat like you?
Oh, like, savage.
Dude.
Savage.
Just go to Planet Fitness, $10 a month.
Yeah, I know. I'm about to join one.
Go to Planet Fitness.
Like running distance for me right now.
Just don't eat the free pizza on Mondays, and you'll be okay.
Just run for the rest of the week.
Do they really have free pizza on Mondays? That's absurd.
They do. And you know why they do it? They do it so that you won't lose weight and you'll keep going to the gym.
It's actually
genius.
Fire them. I do pizza Mondays, taco Tuesdays, fucking chicken ring Wednesdays.
Dude, they have like fucking buckets at the front desk that are like full of like tootsie rolls and shit.
Dude, they're trying to make every day your cheat day, so you work out every day.
Exactly. They don't even care if you work out every day. They just want you to like stay out of shape.
You take this Willy Wonka candy bar.
Oh my God.
Dude, you could like if you go to Planet Fitness, you could run on a treadmill and you'll see like empty Tootsie Roll wrappers like in the cup holders and shit. It's
yo, if I ever if I ever saw it in a gym, if I ever saw somebody eating a Tootsie Roll at the gym, I'd just slap the shit out of them. and they couldn't do shit. No, you can't do shit. You can't do shit. You're at a gym, you're eating a Tootsie Roll. Get the fuck out of here.
So fucking
You're also not allowed to grunt at Planet Fitness.
No, that's what?
You're not allowed to grunt, like, when you're lifting weights.
Oh, I thought you said crump.
Nah.
Like a dance.
No,
nah. Like, there's a whole bunch of, like, there was, like, something.
You're probably not allowed to do that either.
Bunch of, you're crumping on Planet Fitness for no reason. Oh. I was like, oh.
Yeah, no, you're not allowed to grunt, because they're all about no gym intimidation over there. And keeping it, like, you know, friendly for the fat people. But,
fuck the fat people. The fat people are there so they aren't fat people anymore. So they should be saying fuck the fat people, too. Shit.
They should be. They should be punished for their actions, but...
That's it.
I don't know. I don't know, it's 2016, apparently we gotta, like, accept everyone for what they are. Not that I agree.
Charlie sent me this article, obviously an Onion article, but it was a college professor telling all his students, just write down everything that triggers you so that I make sure that I don't talk about anything that could possibly trigger you.
At the end of the article, it was probably like, yeah, it was a 3-month semester of just silence.
No. But the greatest part of the article was that, like, you know, you've had the teacher talk. That the teacher's like, oh, you know, it's going to take me a while to get to know your names.
Yeah,
it was basically the same exact talk, but with triggering.
It's going to take me a while to remember what triggers you.
All your different triggers. You got to understand that I have 30 people in 3 different classes. And blah, blah, blah. I was like, oh, man.
Also, make sure you write down what gender you identify with.
Yeah, exactly.
I identify as a Grimbus, personally. Don't ask me what a Grimbus is, but that's what I am.
Just respect it. Just respect it.
I'm a Grimbus, and
some respect on the Grimbus name.
And I have Grimbus parts to prove it, and I can whip them out right here on this podcast for you all to see. But yeah, let's talk a little bit about the the Jets game tonight. So we lost 14-6 to the Eagles.
So Petty was doing some work.
He did. He made that one really nice throw to Robbie Anderson, and he actually left the game early because he suffered a shoulder injury. I think it was on that touchdown pass actually that he suffered the injury.
Yeah, it was on that touchdown.
Yeah, because Hackenberg came in after.
That sucks. It sounds like he's a Pennington.
It does suck, and I think it changes a lot of things for the Jets' quarterback situation. Basically, we just have to pray that Fitz makes it through the whole season without getting hurt. Because I think what we've learned from the
he will.
I think what we've learned from the preseason is that there really is no second option.
No, there's not. We're gonna unfortunately resort to Geno as a second option, and that's a horrendous choice.
We're gonna have
put Petty in over Hackenberg and Geno, and truthfully. I would like to trade Geno if there's any team willing to take him over injury.
Right. So, Hackenberg, I hate to say it, but he looked very, he looked Sanchez-esque tonight.
He looks very...
Oh, don't say that. Don't fucking say that to me, because I didn't watch the game today.
No, he looked bad. I can't blame him, because, like, he had this shit offensive line. He has these rookie receivers, and...
He has a good offensive line now compared to what he was playing with in Penn State, though.
Yeah, way better.
Penn State's all, yeah.
Yeah, Penn State's all line is garbage. But the play I'm referring to where he looked Sanchez-esque, so Hackenberg was about to get sacked, and he's like, trying to, like, throw it away off his back foot.
Yeah.
And the Eagles defender just picks it off and runs it back to the house.
That was the intro at the end of the third. Not the end of the third, like almost the end of the third. It's like three, 4 minutes in.
Something like that.
I remember that. I was like, all right, fuck.
That's actually when I stopped watching. Yo,
that's when I turned it on, and then I turned it off.
Yeah, I watched, like,
literally that was the play that I turned the fucking. I was streaming it.
I watched like the possession after that, and then I was like, all right, I'm done. I'm going to get drunk.
I started doing that because I knew Bryce, Petty, and Hackenberg were playing. So I'm going to get drunk now, so I don't have to deal with this shit later.
Yo,
that's fair.
Petty.
I was taking it easy. You know, it is the fourth preseason game for the fans, too.
Now I see why he's not playing a game each year.
Now you see why we haven't cut or traded Gino yet.
I kind of would like to see him under center with the first team offense.
First team.
Definitely.
I guess it would be a lot better, obviously, because, like, the players are better. And
I heard comparisons to Brady and Bledsoe between.
I said that. What's his name? He plays kind of like Brady. Like, he has Brady-esque
qualities.
Exactly.
But, like, Bledsoe would be Fitz would go down, and then Petty would step in and have to step it up.
We can only dream.
You know, imagine they just run down the whole roster to the fourth quarterback, and then Hackenberg has to be the one to start, and then
Hackenberg.
If Hackenberg has to start this year, we're going 3-13. We might as well just tank for Deshaun Watson.
I would take Watson. I would definitely take Watson.
I would take him too.
Three QBs in
dude,
3 years.
I actually saw a tweet. You really can't blame the Jets for just taking a quarterback in the draft every year when you haven't had a franchise quarterback since Joe Namath. It's hard to blame them to take a quarterback every year.
Yeah.
Eventually, one of them has to work.
You're wasting a pick on a. I mean, obviously, every quarterback has a chance, but.
It's not like they're wasting a first round pick on quarterbacks every year. That's what kind of makes me okay with it.
When was the last time we chose?
We waste those on defense.
we don't waste them.
Yeah, do we though?
We don't waste. Yeah, it's not a waste. It's just that we always build up our defense.
It's always like it's always kind of disappointing though. Like whenever we draft, like I won't lie, like I like Darren Lee, but when I first heard we drafted him, I was kind of like, really, like we're drafting defense again.
Yep.
Maybe not so much this year as I was in years in the past.
We're still going to stay defense dominating. Shit. No matter what.
As soon as I see him play, I was like, all right, I kind of see why we got him because we did need a middle linebacker. And
yeah.
David Harris is like getting old.
Yeah.
He's definitely falling off. He's already falling off the train. We can't pick him back up.
Really is fast, he's quick, and he's a heavy hitter.
And he can cover.
Calvin Pryor on linebacker.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which would improve our man-to-man.
Right.
I think our defense will be pretty damn good this year.
I think it'll be better than it was last year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's really no reason why the Jets shouldn't be the number one defense in the league this year.
In my fantasy. I definitely should have.
You want to talk about... Can we take a fantasy segment real quick?
Yeah, let's do a fantasy segment. My running back situation isn't ideal. I have... I have CJ Anderson, Devontae Freeman, Matt Jones, and Derrick Henry.
I got Zeke.
Take the deal.
I
hope Zeke gets injured the first game, nigga.
Oh, no.
It's not going to happen.
It's not. He's dirty.
I'm saying he's going to be a bust. I do not think that I see an athlete. When I see him, I know he's going to be good. I saw Trent Richardson. I wasn't sure about it. And, of course, that motherfucker, trash.
Trent was horrendous.
I hope Derrick Henry is not a second Trent Richardson.
Derrick Henry is like, I don't know, like these Heisman running backs are weird to me. I don't trust them. And him, off the ball.
I'll tell you who he is better than that.
Cam Chancellor. And I was like, you know what, take him.
You know who the worst of like those middle of the pack running backs ever in fantasy are? Bishop Sankey. He was always he was always fucking trash, but for whatever reason, there was always this hype around him. Yeah. And I never understood it.
It was honestly, yo, did you see the run they made 2 weeks ago? No. Bishop, man.
Wait, don't, I think I have Bishop saying.
Well, I'm sorry.
I might have like left the draft and got auto drafted with Bishop saying.
Hacker, in your draft I was tight that I had first pick. I hate first pick.
You got first pick?
Yeah, I hate first pick.
That was you?
Yeah.
I mean, you got Antonio Brown, though. I kind of
obviously. I'll be a retard not taking Antonio Brown. He can do well under any quarterback.
I kind of understand why you don't like first pick, because it's like you get first pick, and then you have to wait till like the last pick of the second round to pick again.
And then I have to go back-to-back, so no matter what, I'm not choosing the same position back-to-back. That's just retarded. I'm going to take the top
of each
position that I need. Yeah. That's why, like, my first seven picks were just every position.
I don't have Bishop Sink. You have Delaney Walker.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that's not bad pick at all.
Yeah, that's not bad pick at all.
For my flex, I have Kelvin.
Depends on Mariota. What?
For my flex, I have Kelvin Benjamin. I wanted to take a chance on him.
I think he's gonna
have a good year.
I think so.
He should have a good year. Team, I want a Barnage on my team. I want a fucking Barnage.
I wanted Barnage too. I was waiting, and then someone took. I was like, fuck.
Barnage, and Josh Brown. Josh Brown. I think I got him on one of my teams. I think I have him on your league, Hager.
You mean Josh Gordon?
No. I'm talking about kicker. Josh Brown. Kicker. He kicked, I think, 93% or like 94% for the Giants last year.
Right.
And people are sleeping on him. He's suspended for one game this year.
Because he beat his wife with Tom Coughlin.
Yeah. Not a kicker got fucking suspended the game. But regardless, his kicking percentage is phenomenal.
Yeah, ask his wife.
But you have to take into account, didn't play the entire season, and he only put three in over 50%, over 50 yards. But still, attention as a kicker is pretty damn good.
That's decent.
He did miss that one kick in that Jets game.
Yeah, and then, hyped over that. I was so hyped.
Still. Dude, when that happened, like, I was watching the game, like, by myself in my apartment. When that happened, Paul was literally just getting home from work, Paul opened the door like a minute after the kick was missed, and he walks in and he's like, "Is the game over?" And I was like, "Yeah, Josh Brown just missed the field goal," and he starts flipping out. He fucking threw a vase out the window and then dropped acid.
I would have had my dick out the whole time.
I think
he's a top tier kicker.
Oh, he definitely is.
Yeah, yes. he could be another Akers, Vinatieri, Janikowski.
Honestly,
fucking
Gostkowski is the best fantasy kicker you could get, though.
Oh yeah, Hauschka is actually one of the top three. I think.
Yeah, he definitely is. Honestly, before he missed that kick against the kick in the playoffs
for Baltimore.
No, Blair Walsh.
Blair? Oh, you're talking about Blair.
For the Vikings?
Are you talking about his miss?
For the Vikings. He missed that, he missed that 26-yard field goal in the playoff game against the Seahawks last year. But before that, he was up there.
It's true, though. How can you get anger at him? How can you get angry at him? He was doing his job. All right, he fucked up once.
That was like one of the coldest games of the year.
Yeah, it was like negative slavery degrees out in that game.
You see, if I was a football player, I'd be like, "Yo, coach, man, I'm not playing in Minnesota ever." Ever.
Fuck that.
It's going to be in my contract. No.
You have a no trade clause just for Minnesota. You literally go anywhere else.
No Minnesota, no Michigan. I'm not even going to go play in Chicago. No.
I guess Green Bay is out of the question.
Green Bay is definitely out of the question.
So just no NFC North. But at least Detroit's indoors, so you can go there.
Yeah. Detroit, I'll accept as long as everything's closed. I'm good.
Minnesota's close too now. Yeah.
If you play in Detroit, you still got to play one game a year in Minnesota and Green Bay and Chicago. So
yeah, I just wouldn't be in that division.
So no NFC North then.
No, hell no NFC North. If I got drafted to NFC North, I'm like, yeah, I'm playing playing trash for you.
Would you pull an Eli?
Trash. I'm just letting you know right now. Either you trade me for a prospect for draft picks, do something, or you wasted your pick on me.
So you would just pull an Eli on them and be like, fuck you, I'm not playing for you.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that's why Calvin Johnson just said, fuck it, I'm retiring. Honestly,
I was surprised. That Calvin Johnson didn't come back with another team. That's really what I thought he was going to do when he retired.
I
thought he was going to come back with like the Patriots or something.
I didn't think he would. Only because if you ever seen, I saw a video like his hands are so fucked up from just the quarterbacks just shitting on him.
Yeah,
like not shitting on him because he obviously shit on them, but like just
they're always trying to like
shit out of them. Yeah, I mean
at the line, I'm sure they're trying to jam him up and fuck with his hands and shit.
And they're hitting his hands. Everyone's just hitting his, like, all right, you know what? You're gonna beat me, but I'm gonna hit your hands so you're not gonna catch this shit.
Yeah, because like, what else are you supposed to do?
Dude, he's like
6'5",
like
yeah, he's a big dude. He bodies everyone. He can make a catch on three defenders, one-handed. It doesn't matter. He's a dirty receiver, but he's getting bullied. He's trying to run his routes. He's getting bullied.
It also took forever for the Lions to do anything to get him any sort of help.
Yeah.
I mean, they signed Golden Tate in like for his last couple of years.
Yeah, 5,000 yards because like, fucking 1,500 those with Calvin.
Yeah, Calvin Johnson was like 2,000 of those.
Yeah.
That must have been nice.
I won that year. I won 2012 and 2015. Those are my 2 years, that's it.
No, it's absurd though, the bullshit that he had to deal with playing for the Lions. Honestly, so, he should never resign. That was his mistake.
Yeah.
He could still be playing right now if he didn't resign.
Was it a mistake, though? I mean, he made so much money off that contract.
He did. He did make a lot of money. But still, he could have made a lot of money elsewhere. Probably not as much. But still.
I think any team would have paid him that much, though, at the end of the day.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say any team would pay him that much because...
Any team that could afford to.
Not necessarily could have with what they wanted to do at the time.
Any team that could afford to shell out that type of money would.
Definitely would have. I agree with you there. If any team could afford to pay him, oh yeah, they definitely would have.
Yeah. So I named my team Discount Double Crabs because I got Aaron Rodgers and Jameis Winston. So.
No, you got Aaron Rodgers, you sick son of a bitch. I got Big Ben, and I got Matt Ryan.
I got Rodgers in one, and I think Russell in the other.
I'm in this one league. I didn't even want to be in...
No, who you get in this league?
I'm talking about this league.
In Hackers League, I think I got Russell.
And just Russell?
No, Russell and...
Andy Dalton. I'm looking at your team.
Yeah, I pick up Dalton, because I'm planning to trade Dalton. Yeah, I'm gonna trade him.
I was debating on taking him or Matt Ryan.
Oh, I'm gonna trade him. Dalton's gonna put up points. Dalton always puts up points. Always.
Yeah, Matt Ryan because he got Julio Jones.
Exactly. Dalton.
A big thing you also have to look at with fantasy quarterbacks is garbage time. Like Blake Bortles is actually a really good fantasy quarterback just because he puts up garbage time numbers.
With AJ Green.
Yeah.
who I had last year. I had AJ Green and Odell as my top, as my receivers. My quarterback was Carson Palmer. Running backs was Devonta Freeman and David Johnson.
And all right.
And then my tight end was, my tight end would switch because I had a shit tight end.
Damn it. I want to check my team right now. I want to check my team.
My flex was James Jones, and it would switch between him and Brandon Cooks. And my
too many cooks.
Cooks.
Too my many defense, cooks.
My defense was. What was my defense? I think I had Packers defense. I switched a lot of defenses.
Yeah, you see, that's the thing. The first pick, I was picking up.
You picked up the Denver defense in like the
third. Yeah. I had to, son. I had to.
When you do shit like that, the thing it does is, like, it starts a trend, because once one defense goes off the board, someone else is going to panic.
Other defense is going to go, exactly.
Yeah, someone else is going to panic and be like, oh, shit, yeah, it's time to draft defense.
That's the thing, that's the thing. I was aware of that, I was aware of that, but at the same time, I was like, you know what? I don't want someone else to start defense before me.
And you might as well, you might as well get the best one.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what I did for pretty much every position, but running back, kicker.
And you got two kickers.
Yeah. Like I said, I got two kickers. I got one kicker looking to trade him, and Andy Dalton looking to trade him in the future.
Want
to
trade Dalton for who?
Well. You should just hold on to him as
your running back.
I have Rashad Jennings.
Dude, you should honestly just hold on to Dalton and just keep two quarterbacks. You need a backup.
Yeah. I know I need a backup, but it depends on when the bye week is for Russell. Because I think I have Russell in that league. So, if Seattle's bye week, I think it's like week 11 or something like that. Shit, that's why.
His bye week is week 5.
On week 5?
I just looked at it.
I have, that's my issue. And then, I have a wide receiver, a quarterback, and a running back by week 5. That's the biggest reason why I picked up Dalton. Yes, that was the biggest reason why I picked up Dalton.
And then Dalton's bye week is week 9.
I needed to do that week 5. So that's week 5. I can toss him out.
Yeah.
So
after and you could drop one of your kickers week 5 and pick up a real player.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm in this other league. I didn't even want to be in this league anymore because it's like a bunch of people I don't know and like this one girl I don't talk to anymore. But like the league automatically renewed itself and it drafted tonight and I was like in it and I ended up. It's retarded, dude. It's a 2-quarterback league, so you have to start 2 quarterbacks every week.
I wouldn't pay attention to it. Three wide receivers.
And 2 flexes, and my 3rd-string quarterback in that league, because I didn't draft, was Romo.
Wait, how many? How many players do you have playing in a week?
How many players do I have starting?
2 quarterbacks,
3 wide receivers, 2 running backs, a tight end, 2 flexes, a defense, and a kicker. So,
that's retarded. You're having 11 people? No, that's dumb.
It's absolutely retarded.
I would take out the QB, and then I'd rather just pick up a whole bunch of defensive players individually. I was thinking, actually, of making the league with 2 linebackers, a corner.
We did that once.
Didn't you do that a couple years back? I was in that league.
Yeah.
I don't think that's that bad.
I think I won that league. If I'm not mistaken, correctly.
Fantasy, as long as you're playing with people who actually know shit about defense.
Yeah. It has to be with people who know shit about football, first of all.
Yeah.
But this is what I was gonna do. I was gonna do the standard quarterback, back, 2 wide receivers, a flex, defense, tight end, kicker, and on defense it would be. I was debating if we should pick a team or not. Or we could just do individual, like, and completely wipe out the whole defensive team thing.
And well, so, if it would depend on who's on it. Honestly, if I'm picking defense, mm-hmm. I want money on the table. I wouldn't want to do a free league playing defense, thinking that hard for that shit. No, I want money on the table for that shit.
Absolutely, because that requires too much work. But defensive line, not like one individual, just a whole defensive line. Two linebackers, a corner, and a safety.
That's not bad.
Yeah, I thought that was straight.
That's not bad.
It would probably be a little confusing.
I like that.
Having like a team defensive line and then like one linebacker and then a corner and a safety. I think if you're gonna do defensive players, you should either do like if you do it by team, you should do it like team defensive line, team linebacking core, and then team secondary. I feel like you should either do that or just do like
an individual.
Or two like a front seven and then a secondary.
But then also with that, you look at some secondaries and you're like,
Exactly.
Speaking of secondaries, so I know you're about it, Mo. But so you want Justin Burris as the number two corner?
Absolutely.
Burris?
I've seen enough of him to want him to start. I definitely trust him over Russell Screen and Marcus Wood.
So what do you do with Williams? Move him to nickel?
I would move him. I'd still keep Russell Screen at nickel. I'd probably keep.
So just Marcus bench Marcus like Williams.
Yeah, I'd like package him in, I guess.
That's fair. Yeah, he has played pretty well in the preseason. From what I've seen.
Yo, my bad. I just went to the bathroom. But, I'm liking his coverage. Like, he plays really close coverage. I like the way he plays.
Yeah, he jams receivers at the line, which is cool.
He does. I like that. And, damn, that sounds like a DJ Khaled.
I like that. I haven't been following his Snapchat lately just because I don't have time.
The Broncos did it. They went to the Super Bowl. They started Revis. Look at Revis now. And I find no problem with starting Justin Burris. I think he's good enough.
Definitely.
But that's just my opinion. I don't know what they're going to do.
I'm sure he's at least getting a roster spot. Another thing I wanted to talk about.
You want
to
talk about the whole 50?
Yeah. Part of what I wanted to talk about with that was we have three really good rookie wide receivers in Sherrone Peak, Robbie Anderson, and Jalen Marshall. Todd Bowles was saying there's a possibility that they keep all three.
Right. And the one I think they would cut would probably be Kendrell Thomas.
Or Devin Smith. I mean, Devin Smith, of all people, Devin Smith should be the one to get cut if that's what they will do.
If it was up to me, I probably would cut Devin Smith.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, what has he shown you, really?
He didn't show anything in preseason.
He's a second coming of Stephen Hill. Oh, you know who absolutely has to get cut, and I hate to admit it because I was real high on him when we drafted him, but I think it's time for Jason Morrow to go.
Jason Morrow, yeah.
You know he.
You don't have to be optimistic about it. He does need to get cut.
No, no, I was, what I'm saying is when he was first drafted, I was optimistic about him. But it's actually funny, I saw something on Twitter that apparently Jason Morrow in like a press conference said that he said something along the lines of, I've never been worried about getting cut or making the roster. It's like, and it's like, this is one of those situations where your actions are indicative of your words, because you play like trash, so maybe you don't care about getting cut. So,
well, obviously, if he doesn't care about getting cut, I think he should get cut.
He should absolutely be cut. But then the question is, like, we got to pick someone else up at tight end, because who else do we have? I mean,
they're putting another one on tight end.
Yeah, he could be our number one tight end, but you still need a second tight end.
Right. And
so they'd have to pick somebody up.
I'm thinking they're going to put Sudfeld in there because...
Yeah, that's true.
He's the only one I've actually seen do something.
He's definitely better than fucking Amaro.
And Kellen Davis.
Oh, man. Kellen Davis is worse than Jason Morrow. I think Jason Morrow, there's just more of a magnifying glass because he's a second, because he was a second round pick, and because he talked all that shit. I think Amaro, if my memory serves me correctly, Jason Morrow of all people. So the year after Rex was fired, Amaro spoke out and said that the Jets had a tardiness issue under Rex Ryan. Which was something I kind of always thought was the case, like, ever since he became a coach. I was like, oh, yeah, Rex definitely is, like, the type of coach to just, like, let players be late to practice and shit like that. Like,
when was he drafted? 2014 he was drafted?
Yeah, yeah, and Rex's last year.
Right.
So him of all people, he speaks out and says, oh, the Jets have had a tardiness issue. It's like, all right, you know what? I believe that, but it's also like, who the fuck are you? Like, you just came into the league. Like, if this was like Calvin Pace saying this, then I'd be like, okay.
Yeah, right. And he apparently wants to come back too.
Pace?
Yeah.
We don't need him.
Really? No.
But I'm sure there's a team out there that could use his services.
I'm sure part of the general manager wants him back.
I don't know about that, because I don't think
McKagan
even wants him back, though, because he's McKagan's on his own shit. I don't think he really has any attachment to any of these players.
No, he doesn't, because he's new to the team, so it's like a fresh start for everyone's new to him.
Except he did draft Devin Smith, so... Hopefully he's not too attached to Devin Smith to cut his sorry ass in a couple of days.
Yes, I am.
We got a caller on the line.
We do have a caller on the line.
Keisha?
It is Keisha.
Keisha!
I knew it.
Yeah, they're listening to you.
Keisha, you're on the air.
The motherfucker on speaking.
Keisha, you live on the radio. What do you think? What do you think? No, not fuck the radio. Don't say that. Oh, now you get caught.
Say that.
All right, call me later. Call me like when you get home.
Yeah, but call me before that.
Oh, yeah. Isn't she like a Saints fan or something?
Yeah, she is a Saints fan.
But yeah.
Well, that was our first ever. That was our first ever caller on the Jets and Bullshit podcast. So congratulations, Keisha.
We'll get a live.
Yeah, we'll get an actual phone call in one of these days. I actually
congrats, Keisha. You got a trip up to New York to visit your boy Mo. The only thing is that
Oh, hey, only thing is that she got paid for it. It's all good, though.
Yeah, the only thing is you have to pay for everything.
Rontez Miles, I think we can get Rontez Miles on the podcast. Possibly. I'm assuming
he's not. What, you've been talking to him on Twitter or something?
Absolutely.
He responds to you?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's sick. Yo,
yeah.
Make that happen.
Music SoCal responded?
I'm going to see if I... Who?
Did he freeze again?
I'm talking about Music SoCal, son.
Yeah. Yeah, but so...
I'm pretty sure I can ask him to see if he's down about it.
That would be awesome.
I told him, I was like, you know, you should be starting, no joke, like, over, I hope this doesn't go down on record that he hears it, but, Marcus Gilchrist.
Yo, Gilchrist is dope.
Gilchrist is dope, but I think...
He's a little bit on the old side. Miles is definitely faster. Miles is definitely faster and harder hitting.
A little bit sarcasm, but
no, they're around.
I know he can't do work, but
they're like 27, 28 around there. But Rontez is dope on special teams.
I think that's the main reason why he's a lock to make the roster is because of his special teams play.
Oh no, he's absolutely.
Do you think, I know we spoke very highly of him before, but do you think that Jalen Marshall is going to make the roster?
I think so.
I want him to.
Yeah.
I really want them to keep Peak Marshall and Robbie Anderson, especially Robbie Anderson.
I think of those three, Peak is probably the one to get dropped.
I hope none of them get dropped. It's definitely not going to be Robbie Anderson.
Definitely not Robbie Anderson. He's making the 53.
And Jalen Marshall, he has his question marks, but I think he's one of those players that could make it to the 53-man roster because of his special teams and his he's an explosive punt returner, so he's got that going.
How many of them do you think are just looking at you trade?
Trade? Oh, I have no idea. They actually picked...
Maybe not this year. It's not to be immediate. But build a team that the Jets looking to build right now. How many of them do you think are going to still be around?
I think all of them would be. They don't drop anything. Yeah. I haven't seen them drop a pass yet.
I ain't saying they're bad. I'm saying the Jets are going to look to get something off.
Not necessarily.
I don't think so.
No?
They're three rookie wide receivers. I mean, maybe years down the line... They might end up trading one of them, but...
I'm not saying anytime soon. But are they going to be key into a Super Bowl run?
I wouldn't want to trade them.
Are they going to be key points in a Super Bowl run?
They absolutely could be.
Yeah.
Hey.
Assuming...
These questions, man. I haven't watched them as much as y'all have.
Oh yeah, no. I'm just answering your questions from my opinion.
Yeah.
I think they could be, especially. I think that could be like, especially because Brandon Marshall's getting old. Eric Decker, I think, is older than he is young. I think. Peak Jalen and Robbie Anderson could be like the next, you know, the next nucleus for the receiving core of the future. So I would definitely like to see them hold on to all three if they can.
Yeah.
an icebreaker.
You know who I kind of want to see get cut, but I don't think it's going to happen, is Breno Giacomini.
Yep.
Yo, he is trash.
Man, I've been saying to cut him since last.
Giacomini's not getting cut.
He's not going to get cut, but he should.
No, apparently, I think he's going to start. Like,
he's one of those.
I didn't say he shouldn't, but he's not going to get cut.
No, yeah, that's what I said. He should, but he's not going to.
Yeah.
What? He's one of those players who, like, should absolutely be cut based on their ability, but because of politics and money, he won't get cut because, like, it's too much of a cap hit to cut him.
Yeah.
It would be pointless to cut him.
Also, there's like nobody to replace. There's like nobody to replace him with. You could bring back Wayne Hunter, I guess.
But that's like our weak side. That offensive line, the right side is. Like,
yeah, especially with
Ryan Pitchers and
Brickashaw out too. I think we lost Justin. He's gone. This happens every time.
He's gonna call back.
I don't even know, like, how to. I mean, I guess we'll give him a few minutes, see if he gets back in. Oh, here he is. You're back.
Yeah, through some of our shares, we can really fucking retarded. You guys, like, pixel fucking shit. It's absolutely dumb. Anyways, I had a good question. I can't remember now.
About Breno Giacomini?
No, it was something after that. It was
he said Wayne Hunter.
No, it had some to do with building a team. Remember? Fuck me.
I don't know, but one thing I do want to talk about while we're on the topic is. So, I would say our biggest question mark going into this season, I'd say the biggest question mark for the Jets is probably the offensive line. Because there's no more DeBrickashaw. Fucking Breno Giacomini's trash.
Sucks because our O-line has been kind of questionable for the past how many years?
I mean, we're good at like three out of the
four. On the left side.
The left side is strong. The right side is weak.
That's
kind of always been our problem was filling that right side.
But now both sides are gonna be.
I don't think the left side too much because James Carpenter is a dope right, left guard. And
I want a dude who's on Miami. I want that motherfucker. As soon as that fucking video of him in that gas mask came out, I was like, yo.
That's our dude.
Yeah. I was so hyped that I came out. I was like, yes, he's dropping. He's going to become a Jet. And then Miami picked him up. And I was like.
I thought he was going to become a Patriot when that video dropped because
I was scared he might be
only
Jets are going to fucking take him.
Only Bill Belichick can get away with like drafting someone like that and everyone would be like, oh, he's a genius for taking that type of risk on a player. Like,
yeah.
Just like only Bill Belichick could get away with playing Tom Brady in the fourth preseason game behind the rest of the third team scrubs. Imagine if the Jets did that. Remember when Rex Ryan put Mark Sanchez in the game with the third team offense and he got hurt?
Everyone's like,
that's how Geno Smith's career started.
Honestly, Rex tried to be Belichick in a way. He tried to be. He tried to get known as well as Belichick as a coach, but through a different manner.
It just didn't work.
Didn't work at all.
He didn't have as much of a grasp, because you can't forget, Bill Belichick came up as a, he came up as a defensive coordinator, too, before he was a head coach, but
yeah.
He had more of a grasp for, he had more of a grasp for offense. He had that, and he has that relationship with his quarterback that Rex was never really able to have. Rex was
him and Sanchez suck each other off every night.
Yeah, they're more concerned with, like, sucking each other off than, like, you know, working together as a coach and a quarterback, and that's why it didn't work.
I was so angry at Hardy during that.
I knew as soon as we got Tim Tebow, I knew the team was just going downhill.
Yo, as soon as we got Tim Tebow, I thought there was light in the fucking team. And then we didn't play Tebow. He still kept with this fucking bullshit.
And then they bench Sanchez for McElroy, who retired.
Who did work for like two games?
did he do work, or did he just like not completely shit the bed? So we were like, oh, this guy's all right.
Yeah,
you know I'm a Jet fan. I call that doing work.
That is doing work. That is fair. Not completely shitting the bed is doing work. Like, that's why, like...
When you only need to put up...
I think that's why I like Fitzpatrick so much. Is because Fitzpatrick is a very mediocre quarterback, but...
He fits in well.
He's the most competent quarterback the Jets have had since fucking Brett Favre. Also...
I was going to say since Testa Verde.
Yeah, I mean... That's probably more accurate because even Favre was kind of incompetent, but
yeah, Favre didn't give a shit about the Jets.
Oh, Justin, did you hear? So Fitz did like so the Jets had like this like
the luncheon.
Yeah,
the luncheon. Is that what you're talking about? Yeah.
Did you hear it? All right, we're gonna play Fitz's stand up from the luncheon real quick, just because.
I was telling Hacker about this. I was like,
we talked about how we were gonna play this on the podcast. So, I gotta find
this. He's a character.
He is a character. I loved when he was doing the interview after the Cowboys game last year, and then like. Mangold like
yeah.
runs up on yes. him, and then he's just like, oh shit,
yes,
oh shit, is this live?
Oh man, that shit is too funny. That was great. Honestly, yeah. This is a great human being, and I knew he was gonna sign with us.
Yeah, I figured he would sign.
He had nowhere else to go, and he loves the game.
Well, he said that he was eventually gonna sign.
Yeah, I know he's eventually going to sign. We were talking about, oh no, we're not going to have Fitz, we're going to be with Gino. No.
I was getting to the point where I thought it was going to happen.
I thought maybe
he's not going to come back, but it just is a political thing, I feel. Not political, more of, he just don't want to do shit.
At the end of the day, there's too much talent on the Jets roster right now for them to be wasting another season on finding out if Geno Smith is the guy. You have to go with someone who's at least proven.
Another thing.
He also broke the record for most touchdowns for the Jets.
True. Between Petty and Hackenberg, who do you think is going to be a better study of the game? Who do you think is actually going to be on the sideline looking at what's going on, seeing the plays, the possible order they can call?
Hackenberg.
And see how they can run the game better than it's being run, even if we win.
Right now, I would say...
What is that, because he's so green?
Right now, I would say Petty. But I mean,
I'm loving Petty right now. I haven't watched him play, unfortunately. I haven't watched any preseason games.
Oh, he threw a dime.
I watched some of the last one.
He threw a dime up to Robbie Anderson tonight. Aside from that, I mean, after that he got hurt, so it's kind of unfair. It's kind of an unfair assessment. I didn't see a whole lot from the Giants game. I heard he wasn't too good in the Giants game, but
no, he was terrible.
I mean, if you look at what they've done on the field, and just obviously it's kind of unfair to say because, you know, Petty's in year two and Hackenberg's a rookie who's just, you know, who's just starting to play. So it's really hard to say, but right now I would definitely say Petty can definitely do a better job of digesting a play and seeing what's happening on the field than Hackenberg can. That's not to say that can't change in the future, though.
Yeah. But, he does a better job of Gino, too.
Yeah.
But
Gino just stares down. Gino just looks at a receiver and just stares him down until.
But your question was, who do you think would be more observant on the sidelines? I think it would be
Hackenberg. Yeah.
Because he fucked up
more. Hackenberg, I see what you're talking about. He fucked up.
I could see.
He's going to be just taking lessons the whole year.
That's kind of what this year's all about for Hackenberg, is just taking in as much information as he can. So maybe he will be paying more attention to Petty. I don't know. It's a hard question to answer. Real quick, I'm gonna play back that Fitz video though.
Yeah, do it.
From the
okay.
I wanted to
come on, Montana, you start using my laptop. Anyways, I don't know what you guys just last said, but
we're listening to the Fitz luncheon.
Oh,
sets with the play clock until we get the next playoff. Just kind of wanted to give you a brief example of and some insight. What's going on in the huddle, some of the conversations, some of the talk, just so you guys can experience that.
Sadly, this is as loud as it'll go.
Ball is set by the official. Clock's at 40 seconds. This is probably going to take like a minute and a half, not 40 seconds. But the clock is set at 40 seconds. Linemen saunter back to the huddle. I'm also over there. We start changing personnel. It's 38 seconds left on the clock. Linemen are in the huddle talking about the last play, the block. 36 seconds on the clock. I hear Mangold ask me about my beard and what kind of product I use. Okay. We get into discussion. We got 32 seconds left. Certain smell comes into the huddle. Okay, who did it? 28 seconds left on the clock. We start looking for Tommy Bohan and Quincy Enunwa, you know, the guys that eat all the protein. They're not in the huddle. Not one of them. It's James Carpenter's dreads. 25 seconds left on the clock. At this point, I've got a radio in my helmet, and so I'm getting the play that's coming in from upstairs. I got it. I got it locked in. I get in the huddle. Forte's in the huddle. I haven't seen him in the huddle all offseason, right? So I'm looking at him. He's got gray coming into his beard. I know he's like an experienced guy and all, but I'm not expecting the gray hairs. So I get thrown off for a second. Okay, focus. We're at 12 seconds. I call the play. I got to hurry the guys up to the line.
Honestly, this is like a Harvard speech right here.
In this particular play, I got a signal aircraft into motion to go out to the end of the formation. Well, he makes eye contact with me as he's running by. Can you guys imagine sitting there trying to figure out what I'm going to do versus defense and Eric Decker makes eye contact with you? My mind goes blank. I'm pretty sure he just looked at me. I think he winked. I'm not sure.
You know,
clock's at 3, clock's at 2, what do? I don't know. So I snap the ball, and my safety net, who always tells me he's open, Brandon Marshall's out there. You just throw him the ball up, and he catches it, right? And that's a successful play. But that's kind of my life and how it happens.
That's not a bad life to have. Eric Decker. Eric Decker just looks at you, and then worst comes to worst, you just throw it up to the big black man, and he'll catch it.
Yo, Stafford knows a lot about that.
Stafford.
He's not gonna know what to do this year without him, though.
He's gonna throw it to the small side.
Stafford's finally gonna be rated as he should be this year.
He's gonna throw it to the small side. Trash. He's
gonna be trash. Oh my god, Stafford's entire career, all his money's made, has been all to Calvin. He should be giving Calvin 50% of his check every fucking check they receive. Every week. Calvin, here you go. Don't worry, Calvin. I still have a couple mil for myself. You'll be okay. On top of all the mils that you deserve. Because you're fucking...
Don't worry. Speaking of that, you
want to
talk about the Kaepernick situation?
Yeah. I guess we should.
Oh, Kaepernick.
I was actually meaning to... I respect it, too. The weird thing is that, like...
100%.
I respect it 100%. I think he has the right to do whatever he wants to do. If he doesn't want to if he doesn't want to stand up for the national anthem, I think that's his right. What's weird to me is that
you don't need to.
Yeah, you definitely don't have to. You know, you definitely, and it's like all these people who are saying, "Oh, all these veterans died for your right to live in this country." It's like, no, those veterans actually died for your right to not stand up. Like, you're... like, so these people...
died for your right to stand up or sit down.
These people shed blood, sweat, and tears for your right to do something, and now, God forbid, someone exercises that right, and now you're fucking mad about it?
Of course.
And honestly, of all the people that have spoken out about Kaepernick... there's not one of them who I have not thought at one point in my life was a racist.
That's because anyone who sits there and thinks that the flag is, like, a god.
Yeah.
It's racist.
What's funny about it is most of these people most of the people who think that Kaepernick is, like, wrong or whatever, a lot of those people are, like, conservative, Republican, Trump supporters. But what they don't realize
is... all of them are. Every single one of them are. If they're not, prove me wrong, please, please, because I 100%.
What they don't realize, though...
the problem with Kaepernick's movement is a Trump supporter.
What those people don't realize, though, is how much Kaepernick and Trump are agreeing with each other without agreeing with each other. Because both of them have said, like, oh, America's not great. You know, we need to make America great again.
Right.
Albeit for different reasons, because Donald Trump has never
that's
really...
the thing. It's different reasons.
And that's what it is. It's like, oh, no one wants to talk about, you know, minorities getting abused by police and oppressed by the government. Let's just talk about the illegal immigrants coming into our country and fucking everything up. I'm going to vote for Donald Trump because he said he's going to bring back the steel mills. That's like every fucking, Yinzer in Pittsburgh.
He's going to make America great again.
Yeah, I like him because he speaks his mind. No, you like him because he speaks your mind for you, you racist son of a bitch.
Yep. but that's the key word right there, great again. It's not great right now.
But when was it great?
I've been saying this since March. I really hope that he comes out and says his entire candidacy was a fucking joke.
That's what I thought this whole time. I really still believe it, too.
He's going to get elected, and...
I really hope so.
At his inauguration speech, he's going to be like, oh, wait,
If he did that in his inauguration speech, that would be so game-changing.
Imagine he was just like, oh, wait, I never expected this to get this far.
He'd hands down go down as
no thanks.
Jesus.
He would. I would actually have a lot of... If he did that at his inauguration speech, if he was just like, you know, I was never expecting to get this far, like, can we not? I'd have a lot of respect for him. But,
He wouldn't even have to do that. He wouldn't have to do that. I would rather him just go up to the fucking mic and laugh. And just sit there laughing.
Just be like, you are all because, fucking because idiots.
The cameras will keep rolling for 30 fucking minutes of him laughing. Of him fucking laughing. And then he go, this was all a farce. He say it in the most like politically etiquette way possible. But just to shit on everybody.
And all of you that decided to vote for me, you are all fucking idiots.
You are all fucking idiots. Let me get back to a point that I wanted to make about Kaepernick, though. Like I said, I support him 100% if that's what he wants to do. The thing that's weird to me is, sure, like, when did Colin Kaepernick become... Because back in the day, I always kind of thought of Colin Kaepernick as kind of a fuckboy. And then he got this, like, he got this Arab girlfriend, and now he's, like, all about, and now he grew a fro, he grew the fro, and he's all about, like, and he's all about, like, all about this political shit. It just kind of came out of nowhere, so.
It kind of comes out of nowhere, but.
I think part of it is he wants attention.
I just don't like people saying it's like a cry for attention. Because I don't think he's the type of person who would cry for attention.
I don't think so either. But see, the thing is, with him, he seems to be like, he's been holding it in, and people always say, like, athlete.
He might have been holding it in, but still, at that stage, the national image that he took on right there.
Right.
Yeah, that's more than just a cry for attention. That's... making a statement.
The thing, like, they were even showing him how he wore like socks with like pigs on them. And, and he says he has like uncles who work for like police, and he's basically what he was like trying to separate between like police who actually do their job right, and like the ones that just go rogue are him.
Yeah. Can we just talk about how, like, singing the national anthem at sporting events is fucking stupid?
It's absolutely retarded.
It's such a waste of time.
No. The World Cup.
You know what, though?
The only country that happens at every single sporting event.
For an international event like the World Cup or the Olympics, I understand the national anthem, because that's actually, like, a world event where you're taking pride in your country and you're competing, competing on behalf of your country. So I understand singing the national anthem in the World Cup or the Olympics, but you know, and it has its place in American sports a little bit too. Like, it'll be cool, you know. Like, they should sing the national anthem on 9/11 for opening day. You know, they should do that. Or like when the Boston bombing happened, and at the first Bruins game after the after the bombing, the whole crowd started singing. Like that was cool, but
it's understandable. It's a pride thing in that sense. Yes.
For a baseball game in the middle of August, like, you don't need the national anthem. I'm sorry. Like, it's a waste of time. It's stupid. It's like, it's smelling your own farts is what it is.
Well, Hecker, if you don't like America, get out of the country.
You know what? Maybe I will.
That brings up another good point that I wanted to say.
All right. Honestly, that's the response you'll get.
No, I can't stand when people say "get out of the country," because when I was taught, it was okay. There's a problem. Why would you want to run away? You'd want to fix it, right?
Yeah.
I think that's his whole goal, just to like. Make America better, obviously, and everyone that, like, they just jump to conclusion about how he's, you don't like the military, but why, like, he specifically said,
he never said a word about the military, though.
You can tell his intentions aren't, like, bad.
Yeah.
He's not trying to, like, say, fuck America, I hate this fucking country, I want to get out.
That's crazy. I never realized that he actually never said a word about the military at all.
But he did say something about the military. He was saying, this is nothing against the military.
Exactly. Okay, so he said that.
Yeah, but he never addressed them. Like, oh my god.
Like, with his first statement, yeah, he didn't address them at all.
I think he had to say it because, I think he had to say that it was nothing against the military because at the game tonight, it was a military appreciation day at, like, San Diego or whatever.
Of course, yeah.
So he had to, like, you know, he had to make it clear that he's not against the military.
I want to see what he does on September 11th.
Also, the other thing that pisses me off about the whole...
Are you talking about Obama?
The other thing that pisses the thing that pisses me off about the whole situation is everyone who's talking about it, nobody's talking about what he actually is talking about with police brutality. Instead, they're just talking about how, you know, he's like a little piece of shit who won't stand up for the anthem and how he needs to get the fuck out of the country.
He didn't stand for a song. Hecker, he didn't stand for a song. If you were at a Whitechapel Between the Bear and Me Faces concert and you mosh, you're exiled.
Well, yeah, obviously.
So, your president's the same.
Exactly.
President's candidates, each other the same.
The best is, all the people trying to burn, trying to burn his jerseys too. There was this one video.
Oh, God.
There was this one video. It was this white trash Eagles fan. He's like, he's making this video. He's like, first of all, he pronounces his name wrong. He's like, yo, you heard about Kaepernick? he's like,
that sounds like someone who is racist.
This guy's like 35 years old, and you can tell he's like. He's, like, recording this video, like, in his mom's backyard, because I think at the beginning of the video, his mom's, like, yelling at him, like, oh, you better take that shit down or something, and he's like, I will, but I'm making a video right now. He's like, hey, did you hear about Kaepernick? Guy who wouldn't stand up for the national anthem?
You heard about Kaepernick?
He's like, well, I'm gonna burn his jersey right now. This guy bought a brand new Colin Kaepernick jersey. Like,
he bought one just to burn it.
He had to have the tags were still on it. The tags were still on
it.
It must have been like $100. So
you know what?
So he tries. Hold on.
After, alright.
He tries to fucking light it on fire. He dumps gasoline on it, and then he's like trying to light it on fire. Dude ends up lighting his flip-flop on fire instead.
Dumbass. Sorry, it's hilarious.
Yeah.
Honestly, though, if I was gapping it with him, I would take another step further because I would claim the fame of the character and be like, okay, you had no right to post this, and you're defaming my character. Yet, as long as the court rules that you're right, you're good.
But I think it's weird, like, all these, arguments against Colin Kaepernick, like, they all sound the same.
They really do.
They really do.
They all sound the same because there's only one base, like, group making up these arguments.
Which we've stated before. They're all
Trump. Racist conservative Trump supporters.
Yeah.
Okay. And there's just to debunk the theory that all these there's a hashtag going around veterans for Kaepernick, like basically it's like veterans
who are standing in solidarity with him.
Like, that like support what he's doing.
I actually share the Jim Wright shit.
Yeah,
that is the first one that I saw.
I think that big essay that he wrote. I think that was what like kind of started the Veterans for Kaepernick movement,
which is absolutely great.
Yeah,
it's stupid.
It's what we need.
Stupid. Oh my god!
You need to have that type of dialogue, like. You're allowed...
Every veteran that I know, aside from, like,
probably people like Andrew Murch.
Yeah, you can name him on the pod.
I don't care. It's not the first time he's been mentioned on this podcast.
Personally, yeah, that is true. Look, I love the kid, but I mean,
it's not like he's going to be listening.
They're fucking archaic.
Even my dad's a vet, and he even understood where Colin Kaepernick's coming from.
I mean, that's what you are truly fighting for.
You're fighting for freedom. Free.
Yep.
Key word.
Yeah.
Free to do what the fuck you want to do.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean that it's disrespectful.
No. If you take it as disrespectful, I'm sorry that hurt your feelings.
He's
sorry. How about you grow up?
Yeah. He said, put your fucking big, like Stephen A. Smith said, put your fucking big baller pants on. I need you to put your fucking big boy pants on.
Sometimes Stephen A's got to put his big boy pants on.
Well, Stephen A. Smith is a racist, too.
Stephen A's got to put his on.
He's a man. He says everything correct. I cannot dispute anything.
I ain't going to say everything correct. All right?
Sometimes he's
a little bitch about shit, and I'm like, yeah, man.
Oh, no, yeah, he is. But I think he does that just for the show.
Come on. I don't know, man. Stephen A.
He is just as racist as all those conservative white people who are mad at Colin Kaepernick. Hot take.
Yo, he'd be mad at white people so much.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
He makes it out on Max Kellerman. Max Kellerman. I don't even understand. This just doesn't make sense to me.
the audacity of that statement.
You have the audacity to say that. Who was it?
Stephen A is hands down the reason why I've used audacity
in
the most times of my life. Shit.
He said, JJ Watt. He's the number one player in the league, and you have the nerve to say Jadeveon Clowney? He hasn't played one game in the league that I've seen.
And you have the audacity to say the best was. Did you ever see the one where Skip Bayless hints at the idea that Derek Jeter could be using steroids,
and he flips out.
He's like, what? I should throw this water on you right now. Did you just say that Derek Jeter, who is class personified, is possibly using performance-enhancing drugs? Not only is the audacity of that statement criminal, but you should be ashamed if you think that Derek Jeter is using...
Oh my god. It's so funny. I do it on Snapchat all the time.
Yo, Mo, I don't have you on Snapchat, actually. I think I need to add you.
Yo, I might do a CBD Snapchat after this podcast.
Alright, I'm going to have to add you.
Yeah, absolutely do it.
We should wrap this podcast up fairly soon, but before we do that, let's remember the next time... The next time the Jets do play, it will be a real football game against Cincinnati Bengals,
I'll be there.
Week 1.
I'll be there.
Oh, we forgot to talk. Let's talk about that real quick.
Yeah, we should probably like preview that a bit. Get into some of the logistics of that game.
Score.
Montez Perfect and Tyler Eifert are both out for the Bengals.
Yep.
They are down one on offense and defense.
Offense rise up to the challenge.
I find no reason for the Jets to lose this game.
I don't see any reason either.
The offense going to work as well as it worked last year.
The Bengals' secondary isn't as good as it was last year either. So
they're not. And Pac-Man is actually hurt.
But wait. Who hasn't figured out the Jets' offense yet?
Which team?
We're going to run the same offense as we did last year this year.
Well, we didn't play the Bengals last year, so they haven't figured it out. The Bills, maybe?
The Bills are probably the only team, really.
Bills exposed us to the point that every team can watch and see.
But the thing is,
can they execute it to the same level? That's the real question.
We had the chance to beat the Bills both times if we fucked it up. I think they're gonna come back and I think they're gonna step.
Instead of the Bills?
Yeah.
The one thing on the other side of the ball, one thing that there is to keep an eye out from the defensive side of the ball. So obviously Revis is going to be covering AJ Green. I'm not too worried about AJ Green. I think we'll keep him under control. But on the other side, I think it'll be if Justin Burris is in fact the number two corner, I think his first real test will be Tyler Boyd, week one, wide receiver out of Pitt. He was projected to go in the first round. He actually broke a lot of Larry Fitzgerald's records at Pitt. He slipped to the fourth round because of DWs and shit. But I think
he's a rookie this year.
Oh
yeah, Tyler Boyd. I think he's a player to watch out for. Definitely Justin Burris or Marcus Williams, whoever the number two corner is. I think they'll definitely have their hands full. So I think that's kind of going to be the X factor in this game is how well our number two corner does against Tyler Boyd. I think that's kind of what we got to look out for. Aside from that, though, I think
I'm not worried about Sheldon Richardson being out.
I'm not too worried about that either, because honestly, Leonard Williams and Mo, I mean, that should be fine. And then even if need be, you could put Lorenzo Malden on the other end as a defensive end, linebacker type of thing.
Yeah, and he's been doing
it. Yeah, he's been doing work. Yes.
Even Jordan Jenkins has been doing dope too.
Yeah. He was tweeting during the game today.
because
he wasn't even there. But
he had I think he has a slight injury. I don't think it's too big, but I'm pretty sure he'll start.
I'm thinking final score, I'm thinking Jets 24, Bengals 17.
24-17, that's impossible.
I was gonna say
23-17. Yeah, either or really.
Those will win.
I might. I gotta. My life's kind of a mess right now. I'm kind of just taking shit one day at a time. After this podcast tomorrow morning, I'm going out of town for a couple of days. I'm going to this music festival in the woods. So I'm gonna be a witness. It's funny because I'm actually probably doing that. So the prophecy of starting this season on acid might actually come true, which would be a great way to start the season. It's better to start the season on acid than to end the season on acid. I think that's what we can learn.
That was the key that you missed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Off on shrooms.
Yeah. Last time I ended a season on shrooms, it was the Super Bowl where the Seahawks beat the fuck out of the Broncos. Because I made a $50 bet with my boy Justin. You remember Jimmy Goodhart, right?
Of course.
Yeah, we made a $50 bet on that Super Bowl, and then I won the bet. So, a couple weeks later, instead of him giving me $50, he just gave me a bunch of mushrooms.
Oh, that worked.
It worked out quite well.
Down
that's currency.
Mushrooms. All right.
Yeah. Remember when?
What were you gonna say?
I was gonna talk about the time when I was proclaimed dead.
Well, that's always a good.
And that will bring the end to the Jets podcast.
Yep. Yeah, we're not gonna discuss that any further. Everybody.
September 11th, 9 days away.
Yep, by the time this comes out, it could be like, I don't know, 3 days away. It could be today.
It's going to be dope.
Today could be 9/11 by the time you hear this. But you know what? It's really 9/11 every day. So opening day is here. Let's go Jets. Peace, love, and crystal meth. Take care.